And she actually didn't see it. She just saw me sobbing. And I just explained that she would see it later. And she would totally understand. So I have to ask you, first question, inspiration for this. It is so unique, so different, and yet so relatable.
Oh, I'm sitting this poor girl crying, it makes me cry. you know, I mean, inspirationally, I just sat down to write it. I had no real plan. I had, for anyone who's ever just written something, I just sat down and wrote something. There was no thought that went into it. I didn't have a plan for a plot or what the story was going to be. And when it was finished, it started becoming clear to me what I was excising and trying to do. It wasn't something I was conscious of when I was actually doing it. My mom passed away 10 years ago. I feel weird talking about it all the time because it feels like I'm using it in a weird way to sell the movie, but I'm not. But my mom passed away 10 years ago. It was the body blow of my life. I was 31 years old. She died suddenly and unexpectedly in a surgery. So it was a bit watching your person that died in a car accident where you were driving the car and watching it happen. And so I hit the floor for a while and I didn't know if I would ever come back from it. And almost a year to the day after that happened, I met my wife. And who reminds me in a non-sexual, non-creepy way of my mom. And so that was kind of, I think, what I was trying to do. I was trying to make a big story about life and these experiences we all have. And life is often in the world right now, it's very dark and it's very cynical. And I tried to tell a story of a family that's shaped by tragedy and a lot of loss and a lot of really hard stuff that metaphorically is what the world is right now. And a reminder that if you push both forward and backwards, it's not all darkness. And we can lose sight of that right now in the world. We can lose sight of that in our day-to-day lives. That was the hope.
I think it came to you. Sort of beautifully. It's interesting to touch upon and just start sitting down and writing. And I think what stood out to me about this film in particular is it's written like a novel. It's not written like a screenplay. It feels like a novel, and that seems to be a little bit of a twist at the end. So did you have that in mind going in, or did that just kind of serendipitously come to you?
Well, it's more what I studied. I was an English major with no plan in life. I studied a Victorian novel, and there was nothing to do with that. And I wound up coming out here and falling into screenwriting. But I was a reader growing up. I wasn't allowed to watch a ton of television. I was allowed to pick 2 hours of TV a week. I was picking Knight Rider at 18. So I read a lot. When I started the movie, I gave Annette Bening the first edition as a gift of 100 Years of Solitude. That was more, in some ways, it was more the inspiration than a lot of those sprawling generational family novels, like the Oprah Book Club ones that we all love. As much as any film or screenwriting class, which I did, I still don't really know how to do.
Well, I mean, it plays beautifully. I think that's what stood out to me, was it felt like reading one of those generational novels, not the older ones.
Yeah.
One of the more little in-depth
sure.
ones. But I also would love to know, where did your inspiration come from, Javi and Javier and Rodrigo? You go from one extreme to Spain and all in Spanish, and I love how unique that it completely just turns 180 and you're in the simplistic story somewhere else.
I mean, I think that was the point. I got to Spain as a young man, I'd fallen in love with a girl. I had a romantic notion of Spain, and so I always wanted to do something there. And the idea was that if we're trying to tell the story of the full human spectrum of loss and love and tragedy and heartbreak and happiness, it shouldn't just be an American story. And the goal here was trick an American wide audience into watching a Spanish subtitle.
I mean, you do it great.
Yeah.
I forget you're watching subtitles after a while.
That's the goal. And a lot of that is due to Banderas, how good he is in that opening scene when it switches to Spanish. What we found, this movie was made for not a lot of money. It was made a lot of money in the real world, but for a film, it was about $13 million, dollar movie.
Which is nothing nowadays.
No, considering the scope of it.
And the cast.
Yeah, they did it cheap. But, I thought this movie would come out on two movie screens. And if it got a groundswell, maybe it's one of those ones that plays in more and more and more. I thought it would come out in two theaters in New York, two in LA. And what started happening was audiences were having a severe response to the film. And in a good way, hopefully. And so we said, let's take it to Kansas City, let's take it to the middle of the country, and I want to see how this plays. And what's very exciting is when we're watching, we're sophisticated but mainstream audience, and it switches to Spanish. And I was like, I don't know if they're going to get going this. And there's a point in the middle of the Banderas scene where he kind of makes a joke. He kind of says his father's in the he left him all the money. He goes, ay, ay, ay. And the crowd, you get a house laugh in the movie theater. And you're like, oh my God, they're really going with this. It's in a different language. They're reading now.
Yeah.
And it's a very cool, it was a very cool moment. That really is, I mean, that's a big scene in the movie that is really all about Antonio kind of like being such a movie star and being so great in that scene that it actually acts as a transitional image for us and you don't even realize what's happening exactly.
He'd be so amazing in that role.
Yeah,
it's like subtle.
And he's a nice guy.
Which is
nice to say. Yeah, he is. They're all nice and you feel it in the film. And so what about my TV show has the same thing. It's like you have an ensemble of people who are genuinely nice actors and everybody always says they're actors, but it's not always true. These guys really are, like it's a nice group of people that I enjoy having dinners with and hanging out with, so.
Well, speaking of the cast, it's a powerhouse cast, first of all. I'd love to know a little bit, how did you get this many names, celebrities, to do something apparently for Phoenix?
People really liked responding to the script, and then Oscar Isaac was the first person. You start with casting Will, because he's on page one of the script. I got, the actor in his generation to do it. So then, when you're offering it to other people and you're able to say Oscar Isaac, that makes it a lot more appealing. I had worked with Annette Bening on my first film. I had a good thing with her. And Olivia Cooke, I produced a little movie called Meet Her on the Dying Girl. Oh. That was kind of her first breakout of the day. So I was able to call upon them and get them to read the script. And to their credit, no one's really the star of this movie. It's a true ensemble. And none of them had any ego about it. And they were all, so it was a really cool experience where you would shoot for 2 days, 4 days, 5 days with each actor and then move on to the next part of the story. And they were all thrilled to do it. And so, and what's really cool about them is that when they watch the film, they compliment all the other actors first instead of having all the normal actor insecurity. And so that's been a really cool part of it too. Annette Bening came over to my house with Warren Beatty and Mandy Patinkin and they watched the movie for the first time. I gave them like Trader Joe's popcorn and it was a really exciting experience. And they're just like all regular, lovely people as famous as they are. So.
I'm sure that was a super surreal moment.
It was. My wife was out of town and she's like, you got Trader Joe's and Christian. I'm like, they love it.
So I have to ask that you've written so many amazing things, but this you chose to direct. And this is, I don't know if everybody knows, this is your second time directing. Danny Collins, amazing movie with Al Pacino, was your first time out of the gate. What compelled you to direct this one?
It was so personal to me, I think, by the end. And it was so ambitious, and I knew it would be dangerous in the best possible ways. And so I'm not a director by trade, I'm more of a writer. I hate directing. It's like you wake up at 5 a.m, it's either really hot or really cold. I never see my wife. It's not great.
It's not glamorous.
And
most people think it is.
No,
it really isn't.
Yeah, and they talk about lenses and I have no fucking idea. And so to direct a movie is to be in complete control of how you're gonna tell a story.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of fancy stuff and you do this a lot and I have pictures of me with like the thing that you put to your eye. I'm looking through the wall. But I wanted to tell the story the way I wanted to say it. I had it in my brain. I hadn't seen the Banderas in my brain. The final scene of the film with Laya talking to her son was probably why I wanted to direct the movie. I wanted to be able to be in control of how that was done. Mm-hmm. And so it wasn't about filmmaking. It was just about, like, I had this one in my bones. I might never do it again. I might do it tomorrow, but I needed to do this one.
So I have to ask. It's something I picked up on watching it and watching it again if you were sitting off to the side. Did it occur? occur to you while you were writing it or when you were directing it that you almost mirror the chromatic energy of the characters in your style of directing? So the first half is you use very interesting shots, it's very cut very quickly, and the second one is slow and simple.
Yeah, it becomes more of a romance and it settles into itself. Yeah, that was intentional. I mean,
which is great, by the way. It's interesting what you pick up on.
Yeah, I mean, I think you need to. The point of the film is, I mean, we have this really strange opening sequence with Sam Jackson, which
is amazing.
Another big name, by the way.
Yeah, he's the coolest. That one was like, I wrote it, and everyone was like, my favorite part is Sam Jackson. Like, when you get shooting, I've never met him. That's about it. I mean, it really is a story. It's like you scripted, but I was like, I sent him the script, and I was like, Sam, would you do this for me? Because it was really just a favor.
Yeah.
And he was like, motherfucker, you wrote my script. So the point of that is to shake the audience and say, like, you don't know, this thing is going to be a little strange and a little unusual. It's going to be challenging. Some people aren't going to like some of the things that happen or the decisions that are made, but in a subtle way, hopefully, like intrinsically, it gets in your bones and kind of braces you for some odd things that are going to come later. And so that was kind of the point of the opening. That's part of the sporadic style, the front part of it, so that by the time you settle into it, like, you're breathing a little bit after you haven't been able to for a while.
I loved it because it's something you don't normally see. Usually, a director sets a tone or whatever.
Yeah. Well, that's what we reward, I think. It's been a struggle for me in my career, especially often with critics who come after sentiment or melodrama or those words which are treated like a plague. But I think what they also, what people get uncomfortable with for some reason in film, and specifically in film, but even I experienced it in my TV show, is people want, or particularly critics want, something to be one thing. We go to see a superhero movie, action movie, a serious, heavy Oscar movie, a drama, a comedy. And the point of this whole thing is just about, it's hopefully about life and regular life. And life is alternately heartbreaking and surprising and funny and romantic and sad. In one day, 1 hour, 1 year, it changes on a dime. And so I hate when movies always can get categorized in the left category. And this thing is like alternately a comedy and a romantic comedy. And then really fucking weird and then sad. And that's kind of how my life has been thus far.
Most people most people live a life like that. It's one moment serendipitous, amazing and wonderful, and the next moment is tragic.
Sure.
And you're kind of just trying to, like, you can't put it in a box.
Yeah.
Which I think this film does beautifully. It does hammer home that message.
Yeah, one of my best friends, but not that everyone in my life is passing away, one of my best friends died very young. And he was a young, vibrant, larger-than-life guy. And his funeral was inarguably the saddest thing I've ever seen. It was also, within that 24-hour span, I probably laughed harder than I had in the last 5 years. I saw beautiful beauty in his family and these heroic people who were dealing with extreme loss and grief. And that was all in literally maybe a 5-hour period. And that's like the saddest of the sad and the highest of the highs and the most biggest community and family. And so to me, I'm often surprised that that is controversial because it's such a fabric of everything we do that I've just always been mystified by that being different.
I find it fascinating as well, just because I feel like critics, if you're absolutely right, they just need a label.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't fit in a label, then it's almost, it jars them.
I guess, we're figuring it out. Yeah, I mean, I guess. I've experienced it back to back with my show and that movie. It's like, it's a complicated thing that I'll never get my head around. I don't really mind it. I'm a little mystified by it, but what do you do?
Well, I'd love to know, talking on your show, which if you don't know what he does, This Is Us. It's amazing, wonderful. I know about that show, and what I love about this is you touch upon human emotions in an authentic way. How do you know when it's authentic enough and not cheesy? Because there's such a fine line between melodrama and drama for the sake of drama and tragedy for the sake of tragedy. Like, how do you walk that line?
Well, I think some would argue my stuff is cheesy. And so all you can do is use your own radar. And I think the thing I'm good at is I think I'm a pretty normal guy. I have a really normal life. I have a really weird job. And it's gotten more public and weirder. but I think my radar, my balance on my place on the scale is pretty much the average person's balance. And I think I'm probably way schmaltzy and cheesy than the cynical critic, but I don't think I go as far as the sappiest sap. And so I think all you can do is monitor that. Humor is a really effective tool as well. Like when you have your heaviest scene, to be able to hit a shy dick scheme right before it is a really helpful tool. Because otherwise you start getting overloaded to the point where like you can't take anymore. And the goal is, I mean, we are making entertainment and we are making things that hopefully will move people. And so you try and put people on a little bit of a ride, I think, that can like help them. Like it's like a roller coaster. So if everything is just going like the big drops are tick up, it's either like really like it's too much, you can't take that kind of anticipation, or you can't take that much of a drop all the time. And so you have to kind of find that ride for everybody. You get 2 hours of movie if you want to take people on through an experience.
It's a very hard balance. So I have one more question for you. And this one might be a little unorthodox, but I told my 4-year-old I was meeting you. And for those of you that don't know, you wrote Tangled. which happens to be my 4-year-old's favorite film.
Sure.
So from my daughter Charlie, her question was, why crying hands?
Because they were funny. I remember my first anime movie was a film called Bolt.
Which is also
a good
one. It's a good one, yeah. And I remember there was this one part where like the cat is getting dragged and smashes into a mailbox, and I was like, and it like makes a fart noise. And I was like, guys. I'm like, we're better than this. Like, we don't need to do this. And then I remember we brought it to the audience for the first time, and the place exploded on the fart noise. And I'm like, all right, well, it's funny for kids, it's just funny. I don't really know. I remember the first Q&A like this I ever did, this is completely unrelated, was for Tangled at some big, big streaming house. And people brought their kids. And they're like, we're going to take questions from the audience. And this cute little 4-year-old girl stood up and she raised her hand and I was like nervous. And she was like, why is Rapunzel's hair turning brown? When they cut it, the magic goes away and it turned to brown. And then they like didn't take the microphone away from her and she's like, but why does it turn brown? And I was like, well, I don't know. I mean, they cut it and then it turned to brown. And the little girls just kept going, nobody was taking the microphone away. Sound and it was the only thing.
It's a great reoccurring joke. If you haven't seen Tangled, it's actually one of our favorites.
Yeah.
And it plays nicely throughout
the entire
time. Well, thank you very much. So for those of you that don't know, Life Itself, it's out in theaters next Friday, September 21st. Please tell everybody.
Please spread
the
word. We need the word spread.
It's amazing, wonderful, and thank you for being
thank
here.
You
right
guys. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.